السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته، أسعد الله صباحكم جميعا. اليوم إن شاء الله معاكم في محاضرة الهيت ترانسفير، واللي هتكون إن شاء الله آخر محاضرة. So I'll try my level best to finish this topic. So as a continuation to the previous lecture, we start with the types of heat exchanger and we reach up to the shell and tube heat exchanger. From its name, we have a shell, which is a very thin layer from the surrounding, okay, which is in a black color. This is the shell, القشرة الخارجية. Okay, so here is the shell, as you can see here. And the tube, we have tubes inside, okay, so here it is. So this is in in the blue color. Represent the tubes. Okay, so this type of heat exchanger is the most common type of heat exchanger in industrial application. As you can see here, of course, this is one type of shell and tube. We have another arrangement I'll show to you later. So what do we have here? We have a tube inlet and a tube exit. So tube inlets mean flow comes from this side and enters only the tubes, which is in blue color. Okay. Now the other region in white color is for the shell inlet, for the other type of fluid. Okay, and you can tell easily that this flow passes like this. Okay, in zigzag motion. Okay, and it will exit. So they contain a large number of tubes. So this is here, you can count them, but in reality you cannot count them. They are sometimes in several hundred or thousand. It depends on the capacity and the size of the shell and the tube exchanger. So they are packed in a shell with their axis parallel to the shell. So here is the axis of each pipe and it is parallel to the shell. Heat transfer takes place as one fluid flows inside the tubes. So here is the first fluid passes here, which is called one, while the other fluid flows outside the tubes through the shell. So the fluid, hot fluid, comes from this side. It will passes over the tubes, okay, outside the tubes. It will cover the tubes from the outside surface. Okay. And here's animation for what happens for the tubes. So here is the inlet for the cold tube, cold flow, and it will passes through the tubes. Okay. And it will go like this, and here we have U-turn. Then it will come from the edge. Okay. Now the other fluid, the hot fluid, will come from this direction, shell inlet, okay, and it will go around because of the baffles, those sheet metal, okay. This sheet metal, as you can see, let me erase this one. This is the baffles here. They are connected from one side and it's open from the other side. The closest one is the opposite from the other direction. So the arrangement of these sheet metals or baffles allow the zigzag motion of the shell tube fluid. Okay. So here they are. So here you can see that here is the sheet metal, okay, or baffles, and from side view or 3D view, you can see they are it has open for the tubes, for the tube passes. So look like this one. Okay. Okay. So here is the tube inlet. So flow comes from this side and enters those tubes. It will enter these tubes and it will U-turn, and then it will go back and go out from this direction. Now the other type of fluid is the shell fluid. It will enter from this direction, okay, and it will go in zigzag motion, okay, until it go to the exit. Okay, time we exit from here. And of course, every device need maintenance. So this is sometimes they do maintenance every 4 months, 6 months. They call it preventive maintenance. Okay, so in any industrial or in any power plant, they have two heat exchangers. One is running, used, and the other is spare parts. So whenever they do maintenance for one device, the other device, spare parts, will start working. Okay, so one is in maintenance, at the other end, in order. So here is the tubes. They will take it out from the chill and they start to maintenance for the tubes, because sometimes the tubes will blocked from inside. I'll talk about this issue in the coming slide. What happens to the tubes when it's in function. Okay. So the chill and the tube heat exchanger are further classified according to the number of shell and the tubes, tube passes involved. So here in this first figure, for example, we have this type, one shell pass and two tube passes heat exchanger. So this is one shell pass, the flow in, inside the shell. Okay, it will come from this side and it will go out, so we call it one shell pass. Okay, two tube passes, because the flow come from this direction, this is one pass and it will go back, this is second pass. So this is why we call it two tube passes. So heat exchangers in which all tubes make one U-turn in the shell, for example, is called one shell tube. The other type, this one, here we have flow come flow in the shell, so it will go like this due to baffles here. This is one pass, then it will come from the other direction. This is two pass. This is why we call it two shell passes. Okay. Now for the fluid flows inside the tubes, here is first pass, second pass, third pass and fourth pass. Okay, so we call it four tube passes. This is names for very simple heat shell and tube. In general, we call it shell and tube. Other types of heat exchanger is the plate and the frame, or just plate heat exchanger, consists of a series of plates with corrugated flow, flat flow passages. So here you can see that we have flat passages, and they are corrugated, alternatively inserted inside this device. Okay, and from this side we have tube that allow flow to flowing inside this passages, and here is the exit. From the other side, we have another flow. Sometimes this flow is the hot flow, and the flow come from this direction is the cold flow. So it will enter cold and it will exit with higher temperature. So this is cold exit, and this is cold inlet. Here the same, hot inlet, very high temperature, and this is hot exit with low temperature. What happens here? Here we have alternative passages. So if the hot inlet from this direction, it will flow in this flat passages, okay? And the other one, it will not flow inside it. It will flow inside the third one, okay? So it's usually skipped one flat plate. Now for the cold flow, it will flow inside this one, and it will skip one, then it will flow inside the fourth one. So this is what happens. So this is why they call it corrugated flat flow passages. Okay. So hot and cold fluids flow in alternate passages. So always they skip one. So here cold, skip this one. This is cold. For the hot, this is hot. Only for hot flow. And the other one we have flow. We have hot. So hot, cold, hot, cold. This is what is the meaning of alternate passages. The corrugated passages, because here we have a lot of passages. Okay. And thus each cold fluid stream is surrounded by two hot fluid streams. So for example, this cold stream surrounded by hot and hot, resulting in very effective heat transfer equipment. And it well suited for liquid to liquid application. Okay, for more clear for this type of heat exchanger, I advise you to visit the Moodle and try to watch this short video. Okay, here you can see very easily that the hot fluid come from this direction and flow inside this one and inside this one. Okay, and the cold fluid it comes and flow inside this one and flow inside this one. So again, cold, hot, cold, hot. Now, why hot fluid pass through this flat plate, not in this one? Because here you can see this black color, which we call it gasket. So gasket, it's open, or it allows the hot fluid to flow inside this flat plate, but it will block the flow for this plate. So the hot fluid will come through this open, but it will not pass through this one. Okay, it will pass in the second one, and here the same, we have gasket, so it will not pass, it will pass through this one. Okay, please watch the video, you will understand the function of this gasket. Other types of heat exchanger is the regenerative heat exchanger. This is another family of the heat exchanger. The previous one was the recuperative heat exchanger. In this slide onward, we call it regenerative heat exchanger. And it involves alternate passage of hot and cold fluid streams through the same flow area. And this is the very important one. Same flow area. Okay? So at the first second, okay, we have hot flow passes through this area. Then in the second seconds, the cold fluid will pass through this area. Okay, so it keeps flow in alternative behavior. But how he transfer from the hot to cold? Let's see. So this regenerative is classified into two types. Static type regenerative, from its name, it's static. So it's basically a porous mass that has a large heat storage capacity. Okay. So this is how heat transfer from hot to cold. We have certain type of material. Okay, porous mass, sometimes it's ceramics, wire mesh, okay, and this ceramics has large heat storage capacity, so it stores heat inside. So when the hot fluid flow in this area, same flow area, then cold passes through the same area, then this ceramics release the heat stored inside to the cold fluid. Okay. Dynamic type regenerator. So we have static and we have dynamic. So dynamic, same principle, except it has rotating drum. This is why we call it dynamic. And continuous flow of hot and cold fluid through different portions of the drum. so that any portion of the drum passes periodically through the hot stream, storing heat, and then through the cold stream rejected this stored heat. Okay. Yeah, so this is the end of regenerative heat exchangers. Heat exchangers are often given specific names, so we have other classification, but this classification does not depend on the working principle. It depends on internal components of the heat exchanger. It depends on the function more. So the classification from here onward depends on the function of the heat exchanger. So heat exchangers are often given specific names to reflect the specific application. Okay, depend on the function, the application of the heat exchanger for which they are used. For example, condenser. It is one type of heat exchanger, but we call it condenser. Why? Because one of the fluid is cooled and condenses as it flows through the heat exchanger, okay? So we call this heat exchanger condenser because of its function, because of its application. One of the cold fluid will condense. Boiler, another type of heat exchanger, okay? Because one of the fluid absorbs heat and vaporizes. So we call this heat exchanger boiler because of its function. Space radiator is another heat type of heat exchanger that transfer heat from the hot fluid to the surrounding space by radiation. So we call it space radiator. More classification, okay, classification of heat exchanger by flow configuration. So this classification based on flow configuration. Okay, so we have counter flow, we have parallel or co-current flow, we have cross flow, we have hybrids. So the counter flow, from its name, the hot fluid flow in this direction and the cold fluid passes in the other direction. Co-current or parallel flow, the two fluid passes in the same direction, okay? Hot or the cold fluid, they are passes through the same direction. Cross flow, this is the cross flow, and the most important one was the compact cross flow, okay, based on the beta. Hybrid, such as cross counter flow and multi-pass flow, so here we have multi-pass flow, and we call it hybrid, okay, and here the other flow. Classification of heat exchanger by construction. We have recuperative and we have regenerative. Regenerative, the most important one is the static and dynamic, okay, and we saw the rotary one. Recuperative, the other types we demonstrated earlier. The most important one is the tubular heat exchanger. A heat exchanger typically involves two flowing fluids separated by a solid wall. So if we take as a sample one tube from Schlende tube heat exchanger, okay? So here in the internal pipe, we have hot fluid flowing inside, and in the bigger tube we have, or in the shell, so we used to name this one as a shell, okay, and what's inside is the tubes, okay, shell and the tubes, remember? So in the shell we have cold fluid flowing, okay, so imagine that here we have inlet, so here is the inlet, and here is the exit for the shell, so here is the exit, okay. Could be parallel, it could be counter. So what do we have? Here we have fluid flowing. Here we have this solid surface, which is the wall of the cylinder. And here we have another fluid flowing. Okay, so here we have hot fluid, internal flow. Here we have wall, cylinder wall. Here we have cold fluid. So we have actually three resistors. for the heat to transfer from inside to outside. The three resistances are the R convection for the hot fluid, so 1 over HI AI, and then we have R cylindrical, so it's better to name it cylindrical, to know that you must benefit from R conduction for cylindrical. And from the outside, we have resistance for the cold fluid, convection, of course. So heat is first transferred from the hot fluid to the wall by convection, which is this one. Okay, so this is the first transfer and first resistance happens. And through the wall by conduction, so this is two, conduction, have conduction resistance. And from the wall to the cold fluid, again, by conduction. You can add here by convection, so, which is the third one. Okay, this one. Do you remember now the R wall or R cylinder? For cylindrical coordinate system. Anyone remember? It was len R out over Rn divided by, this is between brackets, 2 by L length of the pipe multiplied by thermal conductivity of the wall. Okay, or we can write it in terms of diameter. So here it is. So R for wall or R for cylinder. So as len D out over Dn divided by 2 by Lk. Okay. Where K is the thermal conductivity and L is the length of the tube. Then the total thermal resistance becomes summation of inner resistance for hot fluid, R cylinder, and outer resistance for the cold fluid. Okay. So here we have area in and area out. Where is area out? Is this one with larger diameter. Where is area in? This one with smaller diameter. Okay, so here it is. We have area in, which is equal to surface area inside, 2 by RNL or by DIL. And area out 2 by R out or by D out multiplied by L. Okay, so up to here this is area N or R N, and here it is the R out. Yeah, here they are. So D out up to this limit. Okay, and D N up to internal diameter. Okay. And here they are. Now, in order to calculate the amount of heat transfer from hot fluid to the cold fluid, usually we benefit from the overall heat transfer coefficient. Okay, instead of using R total, we used U overall. But here we have a problem. What is this problem? Is the surface area. Shall we consider the internal surface area or external? For this, if we use internal surface area, then we must write internal overall heat transfer coefficient. And if we are interested in the outer surface area, then we must write outer overall heat transfer coefficient. Okay, and here is, let's see. When this problem arises, we'll talk about it, okay? And when we can consider outside, when we can consider inside, we'll talk about it in the coming slides. So in order to calculate overall heat transfer coefficient, you know very well that 1 over UA, or the opposite, U multiplied by A, it's equal to 1 over R, okay? Remember? So R total, summation of three resistances. Perhaps you are wondering why we have two overall, two, we are talking about u in and u out. 2 over all heat transfer coefficients, u in, u out, for heat exchanger. The reason is that every heat exchanger has 2 heat transfer surface areas, area in and area out, which in general are not equal to each other. هلا احنا بنقدر هلا انتم شايفين هون بهذه العلاقه انهم they are equal. So here we have equal sign. So we can say that UA, UN multiplied by area in equal U out multiplied by area out. But individually we cannot say they are equal. إلا إذا كان الأريا إن بتساوي الأريا أوت. ومتى هذا الحكي صحيح؟ إذا كان عندي جدار or cylinder, internal cylinder, very thin cylinder. Okay. يعني the difference between DN with D out very small. So we can say they are almost equal to each other. So if this is true, then area in almost equal area out, and then we can say what? U in equal U out. Okay? But this is true only in this scenario. So we'll have, then we'll not have the conflict with the subscripts. So if they are equal, then we can set U multiplied by area S without looking at this too. Okay. The overall heat transfer coefficient is dominated by the smaller convection coefficient. Okay. Here we'll do assumption actually. We'll assume that R wall is very, very, very small. Very small. We'll assume this assumption. So if it's very small, then it will ignore it. So we end up with 1 over HI and 1 over H out. So if we are talking about ignorable wall resistance, then we are talking about very thin wall. Then we are talking about same area. So this area will cancel out from all terms. Now, we end up with 1 over HI plus 1 over HN. Answer. Now, the overall heat transfer, this is equal 1 over overall. I'll not write in or out. I'll leave it in general. So the overall heat transfer coefficient is dominated by a smaller convection coefficient. So if we are talking about HI, convection heat transfer coefficient for the internal flow is very, very small than H out, or the opposite. Okay, so we are talking about very small value here, and here we have very large value. So 1 over very large value, ايش بتعطينا؟ 0. Almost 0, يعني مش 0 exactly, almost 0. Okay. But 1 over very small value, this magnitude will go to infinity. Okay. 1 over very, very small value will have very large number or infinity. Okay. Infinity means here large number. So U will be affected or will be dominated by HI. Okay, because this term almost vanished, and we end up with this term. It will decide the value of the overall heat transfer coefficient. Okay. So when one of the convection coefficient is much smaller than the other, let us assume that HN very, very small than H out, we have 1 over very small value will become very, very large than 1 over H out, and thus U is dominated mainly by HN. In this situation, or this situation arises frequently when the fluid is gas and the other fluid is liquid. So usually H for gases, this is the scenario, H for gases, usually much, much smaller than H for liquid. هلا بيجي لي واحد بيحكي لي طيب ال H ما هي بتعتمد إذا كان عندي forced ولا natural convection ولا forced convection ولا boiling. خليني أذكركم بالجدول. So كان عندنا جدول هذا إذا متذكرينه. Okay. دائما إذا كنا بنحكي مثلا free convection دائما الغازز لها قيم H very small compared to the liquids اللي لها قيم very high. So إذا كنا بنحكي عن limits upper limit so 1000 very very large than 25. So 1000 for H liquid. So this is for example 1000. And it's very very large than 25. Okay, so متى هذه السيناريو أنا بعتمدها؟ متى بحكي إنه في عندي فرق بين إني أحكي HN وفي فرق بين إني أحكي HOUT؟ مين بهتم فيها أكثر؟ إذا كان في عندي gas وliquid في الهيت إكسشينجر. في عندي one of the fluid is gas, the other fluid is liquid. عندها بيكون في عندي لازم أكون أنا عارف هل أنا بدي أشتغل على الـ inside ولا الـ outside. In such cases, fins are commonly used on the gas side. ليش بستعمل الـ fins؟ لأنه الـ H very low للـ gases. Okay؟ وبالتالي الـ Q convection إحنا متذكرنا مرة وإحنا بنحكي عن الـ Q convection هي تساوي H في area surface T surface minus T infinity. حكينا إن temperature will remain constant. إيش الـ other two parameter? Either H أو surface area. إذا كانت الـ H للغازز وخلص معروفة وما بقدر أغير فيها، في عندي مجال إني أزيد الـ convection فقط بزيادة الـ surface area. كيف أزيد الـ surface area حكينا بوقتها؟ By adding fins to the surface, extended surfaces اللي هم الـ fins. Are commonly used on the gas side. Why gas side? Because it's very low in the gas side. Okay. To enhance the product, you multiply it by A and thus the heat transfer on that side. Okay. So هذه هي ال target. To increase the heat transfer. Therefore, the overall heat transfer coefficient U of a heat exchanger is meaningless unless the area on which it's based is specified. Okay, so لازم دائما أنا أكون عارف على أي مكان بدي أشتغل. The overall heat transfer coefficient U range from about 10 for gas to gas heat exchanger to about 10,000 for heat exchanger that involves phase changes. Okay, so it becomes very significant, very large. The can be in the phase change. You can take a look to this table and compare the value of U for the internal flow water and the external flow is water, liquid to liquid, liquid to liquid. Okay. But it's very, very huge for application that involves phase change. When the tube is fined on one side to enhance heat transfer, the total heat transfer surface on the fin side becomes, so area S total, surface area total, area fin plus area unfined. Okay, this is how we calculate area S. Do you remember H convection, area S? So how to calculate area S? Delta T from here. Okay. But one of you will come and says we must multiply area fin by fin efficiency. Because not all the fins will, not the whole length of the fin will be effective. Okay. So when this equation is correct, if we are talking about isothermal fence. Okay, for short fence, very short fence. بفرضهم إنهم isothermal. كيف؟ For short fence of high thermal conductivity. هذا الشرط الثاني. So الشرط الأول إنهم يكونوا very short in millimeter and conductive. لإلهم very high. We can use this total area, for each fin in the convection resistance relation. So our convection equal 1 over h area surface. Area surface represents area fin plus area m fin. Since fins in this case will be very nearly isothermal. So إذا كانت هذه هي tubes في عندي fins, كانت الحرارة على البيز 100. فإذا كان عندي very short fin conductive على the other side حتكون 100. So الحرارة حتضلها 100 everywhere على طول الفنز. Okay. Since the fins in this case will be very nearly isothermal. Isothermal means الحرارة بتضلها constant along the fin, along each fins. Otherwise we should determine the effective surface area from this relation. So efficiency of the fin multiplied by area fin plus area and fin. إذا كانت مش كل الفن تنقل نفس الحرارة. Okay. بالتالي بلزمني أعرف كم الإفشنسي لهذه الفن. Where efficiency fin is the fin efficiency. Note that if the efficiency للفن equal 100% or 1, we'll go back to the isothermal. Another objective of this chapter is to demonstrate and explain the fouling factor, R fouling. This is the symbol, and here its units. Meter squared multiplied by Kelvin over root. So what do you mean by fouling factor? Usually, why we need maintenance actually for the heat exchanger, or preventive maintenance, okay, or shutdown maintenance. Many types of maintenance actually in the industry. So in general, why we need maintenance? Because the performance of the heat exchangers with the time usually deteriorates. أداء الheat exchanger مع الوقت بتدهور بقل قل efficiency. So the performance of heat exchanger usually deteriorates with time as a result of accumulation of deposits on heat transfer surfaces. So مش احنا حكينا في عندي shell and tubes. خلينا ناخذ مثال بسيط. ممكن يتراكم عندي هون deposits اوساخ. اوكي. تراكمات من الليكويدز او الغاز اللي بنستعمله from outside. ممكن يكون عندي تراكمات from inside. اوكي. هذول الديبوزيتس بيشتغلوا as insulator كأنهم عوازل بيزيدوا thickness. Okay, بيزيد الثيكنس فبتقل الكفاءة بتقل الهيت ترانسفير. So with the time we have accumulation of deposits on heat transfer surface. The layer of deposits represent additional resistance. Okay, so احنا عنا so far لهذا الاكزامبل 3 resistance: convection outside, conduction through the wall, and convection inside. If we have fouling factor at appears, then we must include it, either internal or external. وبالتالي المعادلة إيش بتصير لR total? Convection اللي كنا شايفينها, conduction, we have convection from outside. Now the extra two parameter is internal fouling and external fouling. Okay, so here is the resistance from the fouling. Okay, and in order to convert it to resistance, we need to divide it by area. Why divide by area? Because the units of the fouling is meter squared Kelvin over 1. So if we divide by meter squared, so meter squared will cancel with meter squared, and we end up with degree Celsius or Kelvin per watt. Okay. So the overall coefficient, heat transfer coefficient, or R total, is equal to summation of the internal convection, internal fouling, if we have conduction of the cylinder wall, external fouling, external convection. The fouling factor increases with the operating temperature and the length of service. Okay, يعني مثلا بدل ما أروح أعمل maintenance للheat exchanger every 4 months, بعمله مثلا every 1 year, I must expect that the fouling factor will increase. Okay, the length of the service. Okay, instead of 4 months, 1 year, very long date for service. And this fouling factor decreases with the velocity of the fluid. So as velocity increases, the fouling factor will decrease. Okay. Let's start with solving a problem on this chapter. Okay. And I will show you this, this part. So here we have hot oil is to be cooled in a double tube counter flow heat exchanger. So this is the type of heat exchanger that will solve on it. Okay, so we have double tube, means we have concentric tubes, one tube inside and the bigger tube outside. The copper inner tubes have a diameter of 2 cm and negligible thickness. So here it's mentioned that we have negligible thickness. This is very important. The inner diameter of the outer tube, the shell, okay, remember, internal tube and shell. So the diameter of the shell is 3 cm, as you can see here. And here is the internal diameter of the tube. We can say internal diameter, or we can say diameter because it has negligible thickness. Water flows through the tubes, okay, at a rate of, so here we have water, and at the beginning of the problem we have hot oil. Okay, so water flows through the tube at a rate of 0.5 kilogram. Okay, so مش شرط دائما تيجي الرسمة مع ال مع نص السؤال. Okay, so once قرأت double pipe or double tube counter flow, you should understand that we have counter flow. This is in this direction and this one is flowing in this direction. Okay, and once the problem says that water flows through the tube, it means water flows inside these tubes and the oil will flow through the shell. So here is the flow of the oil, okay, from this word. Okay, so water flows through the tube at a rate of 0.5 kilogram per second and the oil through the shell. So here again, the oil, the hot fluid flowing through the shell, okay, at a rate of 0.8. What is the target? Is to cool down the oil. Okay, so this is the target of this heat exchanger. Hot oil is to be cooled. Okay, and this is the flow rate of the oil, taking the average temperature of the water and the oil to be 45-80 degrees Celsius. Okay, respectively. So this represents the average temperature of the water and this is the average temperature of the oil. Why do we need the average value? Anyone can tell? In order to evaluate the water properties and oil properties. Okay, determine the overall heat transfer coefficient for this heat exchanger. So we need to find U for this heat exchanger. So let's take a look to the 45 degrees Celsius and 80 degrees Celsius. So for water, for example, if I go back, so this table represents the water or saturated water table, this one, and this table represents the engine oil, the oil that we have in this problem. So 45, we are talking about this temperature, okay, so we'll benefit from from this line. Oops. So it will benefit from this line. So what do we need actually? We need density, okay? We need thermal conductivity, okay? We need dynamic viscosity, Prandtl number, okay? We'll see. Now for the engine oil, so at least keep in mind that the density of the water, which is in the liquid form, so here we have liquid, we have vapor, but we have liquid. So the density of the liquid is 990.1, okay? And for the engine oil, the temperature was, the average temperature actually was 80, okay? So here is the property, okay? So keep in mind that the density is 852. Actually, you can write it, okay? I will write with you the property when we start solving, okay? And here is the other property, Prandtl number, kinematic viscosity, dynamic viscosity, diffusivity, conductivity, specific heat, okay, etc. Okay, how to start solving. So let's move to the solving board. Okay, here's the solving board, and I will solve them one by one. Okay, so but as a starting point, okay, we'll write the most important information given from the problem statements. It says that the thickness of the wall, so here is the wall, okay, here we have cold water, and here we have hot oil. And here we have the wall of the cylinder. So it's mentioned that the thickness of the wall is negligible. So we have negligible. Negligible thickness. That means that means 1 over U is equal, multiplied by A for sure, to equal to R total, and this is equal 1 over HN, area N, plus R wall, plus 1 over H out area. That means R wall is very small. So negligible thickness, there is no resistance from the wall. And as a result, area out will equal area in, will equal the area, so I can cancel them together. So we end up with 1 over U, because in the problem, he asked us to find the overall heat transfer coefficient of this heat exchanger. So 1 over U. And then at the end, we will mention this U will be closer to which H, okay? So 1 over HN plus 1 over H out. 1 over H out. So our target now is to find the internal convection coefficient and the external convection coefficient, okay? So let's start them one by one. And in order to find the internal and external convection coefficient, we need to benefit from those relations. Okay, this relation, when the flow is turbulent for the internal flow. So if the flow is turbulent, fully developed, then we can benefit from this relation in order to find H. And if the flow is laminar, this is laminar, we can find the value of the Nusselt number, either this one or that one. okay, based on the knowledge of the ratio between D in and D out. Okay, we'll come to it. Don't worry. Now let's go back to the solving board, and let me start with the internal. So let us start with the internal. Look, and we are talking about precisely about water. Okay. So in the internal flow, we have T averaged, okay, or mean temperature. It's equal to 45 degrees Celsius, and then we can go to the table and benefit from this information to find the water property. So if you go to the table, you will find out that the density of the water is equal to 0.1 kilogram per meter cube, and Prandtl number is equal to 3.91. Okay, the thermal conductivity is equal to 0.637. Okay, gross watt per meter Kelvin, and the kinematic viscosity is equal to 3.794 multiplied by 10 to the minus 5. Okay. Now, the first step is to calculate the Reynolds number to know whether the water is laminar or turbulent. Okay, so in the problem statement says that the water flowing with m dot, so m dot for water is equal to point 5 kilogram per second. Okay, so this m dot is equal to rho multiplied by velocity multiplied by area. Okay, internal area for energy. So from here, the velocity will equal to m dot multiplied by rho multiplied by A. And this is equal 0.5 divided by 0.1 multiplied by the cross-sectional area, which is equal to the diameter for the inner tube is 2 centimeter, so it is by divided by 4, of course, we are talking about diameter, multiplied by 2, divided by 100, all to the power 2. Okay, so this is pi over 4, d squared. Now, let me use my calculator to find the velocity of the water. So, this is velocity water. So, 2 squared multiplied by 3.4 divided by 4 multiplied by 990.1.5 divided the answer, which is 1.61. Let me go to the new base. So velocity for the water is 1.61 meter per second. Okay. Now the Reynolds number for the water gates is equal to rho multiplied by velocity multiplied by d divided by viscosity, or velocity multiplied by d divided by kinematic viscosity. So the velocity we have is 1.61 multiplied by diameter, which is 2 centimeter. We need to convert to meter, divided by the kinematic viscosity, which is 0.62, multiplied by 10 power minus 6. So let me use my calculator. So 0.602, now 1.61 multiplied by 0.02 divided by the answer. So the answer is 53,000. So the answer is 53,000 and this number is greater than 4,000. So this is greater than 4,000. That means the flow is water flow is turbulent. Once it's turbulent, so we'll go back and benefit from this relation. Okay, for Reynolds number greater than 4,000, then the Nusselt number will equal 0.023 Prandtl multiplied by Reynolds. So let me go back to the solving board and write down this relation. So the Nusselt number is equal to 0.023 multiplied by Prandtl to the power 0.4 multiplied by Reynolds multiplied by point to the power 0.8. So this is equal. Prandtl number is given to be 3.91. So this is 3.91. So let me use my calculator directly. So the Reynolds number, which is 53.488, is raised to the power 0.8 multiplied by 0.023 multiplied by 3.91 raised to the power 0.4. And the Nusselt number is equal to 240.6. Okay, and this is equal to H multiplied by L divided by thermal conductivity. And we are talking about H. Let me erase this one. We are talking about internal conduction. So internal convection is equal to K thermal conductivity, which is 0.637. Let me go back and check the value of the thermal conductivity. Yeah, 0.637. So here, we must say that 240.6 multiplied 0.637. Okay, divided by sorry, here once we said we have internal flow, then we'll replace this length with D. So usually Nusselt number is equal to H multiplied by L divided by K. This L, we have external flow, then it remains as L. We have internal, then we replace it with diameter. So yeah, so this is diameter. So the diameter of the internal tube is 2 divided by 100. And we end up with the following value. So this is multiplied by 637. Divided by 0.5. And the answer is 766. 1.5 watt per meter squared. So the internal convection is very huge. Very, very huge. So let's see the external convection. So now for oil, for shell flow, we're talking about oil. So what do we have? First of all, let us go and write down the properties of the oil. So at temperature equal to 80 degrees Celsius, we can go to the table and find out the corresponding properties as what we did in the earlier stages. So the density is equal to 852 kilogram per meter cubed. And Brayton number is equal to 499.3. Thermal conductivity is equal to 0.138 watt per meter Kelvin. Okay, and we need the thermal or kinematic viscosity, 3.79 or multiplied by 10. Okay, now let's start first with calculating the velocity. So it's mentioned that the mass flow rate of the oil is 0.8 kilogram per second. So m dot for oil is equal to rho velocity multiplied by area, cross section area. So velocity of the oil is equal to mass flow rate, which is 0.8, divided by the density, which is 852, multiplied by the cross-sectional area, and the cross-sectional area for the oil is not the outer diameter. Let me go back and show it. So oil come from this direction and flow in this portion and in this portion. So how we calculate this portion? Let us take side view. So here is the side view and here is the internal pipe. So oil flows in this portion. So how we calculate this portion? Simply by subtracting internal cross-sectional area from the external. Okay, so this is multiplied by first of all pi over 3.45. Let me write like this: pi over 4 multiplied by the external diameter is 3 centimeter. So this is 3 per 100 squared. Minus 2/100 squared. Okay. And if we calculate the velocity, if we calculate 0.03 squared minus 0.02 squared multiplied by 4
divide by 852.8 divide answer gives us 2.39 meter. Very slow compared to the water flow. Okay. Now, in order to calculate the Reynolds number, so Reynolds number for this scenario is equal to velocity multiplied by diameter divided by kinematic viscosity. Now, 2.39 multiplied by the external diameter, which is 0.03 minus 0.42, because it's not flowing in the whole pipe diameter, only in this portion, divided by the kinematic viscosity, which was 3.794 multiplied by 10 to the minus 4. Okay, so 3.794 multiplied by 10 to the minus 5, isn't it? So let me use my calculator. So 0.03 minus 0.02 multiplied by 2.39 divided by 3.794 multiplied by 10 to the minus 5. This is equal to 629.9. Which is less than 2,300, and that means here we have laminar flow. Okay. So if we have laminar flow, then we'll go and benefit from the table, okay? But before going to the table, in the first column, as you remember, we have di over d out. So d internal divided by d outside. So we have 2 centimeter divided by 3. And this is equal to 0.66. So now let us go to the table. So as I mentioned, this is for turbulent, and we benefit from this table for laminar scenario. Here is the d internal divided by d external, and our value is between 0.5 and 1, which is 0.66. Now shall we benefit from this value or from this value? Now, this value represents the Nusselt number for inside the heat exchanger, and this is in the outside. So we'll benefit from this value, okay, not from this one. So, and we'll do interpolation between these two values. Okay, so I'll do the interpolation. Let me go back and show to you, maybe some of you forget how to do interpolation. So doing interpolation, so Nusselt number is equal to 4.86 minus 5.74 divided by 1 minus 0.5 multiplied by 0.66 minus 0.5 plus 5.74, and this is equal, so 4.86 minus 5.74 divided by 0.5 multiplied by 0.66 minus 5. The result is added to 5.75. So the result is 5.45. Okay. Now, the Nusselt number is equal to H out multiplied by diameter divided by thermal conductivity. So H out is equal to K multiplied by Nusselt number. K it was equal to 0.138 multiplied by 5.458 divided by diameter, which was 0.03 minus 0.02. And the answer is 75.2. And it is very small than the H for the water. So H for oil, very, very small. So we expect that the U is closer to the overall heat transfer coefficient is closer to the H for the oil case. So the result is 1 over U is equal to 1 over H water plus 1 over H oil, and this is equal to 1 over 7661 plus 1 over 75.3, and the overall heat transfer coefficient is equal to, so 1 over 7661 plus 1 over 75.3, and 1 over everything is equal to 74.5 watt per meter squared. And you can tell easily that this value is very close to 75.3. So if we need to do any modification to this heat exchanger, we'll add fins to the oil direction. So we'll add fins to this side of the heat exchanger. So let me erase it with it. We need to enhance heat transfer in the oil direction. We'll add fins to this region. Okay, so that's it. So we could determine the overall heat transfer coefficient. And this is the end of this course with this problem. You can find more problems in your textbook. So please do not hesitate to ask me any question. And see you soon, inshallah, and stay safe. Assalamu alaikum.